The Invisible Woman, The Story of Nelly Ternan and Charles Dickens, by Claire Tomalin. Narrated by Wanda McCaddon. Copyright 1990-1991 by Claire Tomalin. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Claire Tomalin, care of David Godwin Associates Limited, and was produced in the year 2012 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. I was talking with Mrs. Warner, who gave her opinion with some busyness that theatrical people, players, were not lower in character, etc., than literary people. But I fear this is only the result of a mind, never very elevated, undergoing a process of vulgarisation. William Charles Macready, the actor, reporting a conversation with his leading lady in his diary for the 11th of February, 1847. I suppose that most gentlemen become acquainted with some people that they would not wish all their friends to know that they know. They go about so much more than we do and meet people of all sorts. Emily Dunstable to Lily Dale in The Last Chronicle of Barset by Anthony Trollope, 1867. No conceivable process by which the girl might grow into the middle-aged woman ever seemed to have presented itself to Dickens's imagination. His heroines are perennially young and pure. The fear of ageing, an ever-present horror in a society that demanded girlish women, never seems to trouble their heads at all. Furthermore, though spinsters are acknowledged to be laughing-stocks, the Dickensian heroine must display no eagerness to get hold of a husband. Ideally, she should be perfectly unaware of the facts of life, and will imagine that the man who is forcing his attentions upon her is really applying to become her brother or father. John Carey, The Violent Effigy, A Study of Dickens's Imagination, 1973. Marry this woman? Marry at 18 an actress of 30? Pah! Pah! I would as soon he went into the kitchen and married the cook. Major Pendennis in The History of Pendennis by William Makepeace Thackeray, 1850. Part 1. 1. N. This is the story of someone who almost wasn't there, who vanished into thin air. Her name, dates, family and experiences very nearly disappeared from the record for good. What's more, she connived at her own obliteration. During her lifetime, her children were quite ignorant of her history. Why and how this happened is the theme, and how, by a hair's breadth, she was reclaimed from oblivion, despite strenuous efforts to keep her there. She was N, otherwise Nellie, Miss Ellen, the patient, the princess, ELT, the dear girl, the darling, the magic circle of one, the little riddle, Miss T, Miss Fernan, Miss Terman, Miss Teeman, Miss Turnham, and probably Mrs. Tringham. She played a central part in the life of Charles Dickens, at a time when he was perhaps the best-known man in Britain. The relationship lasted for nearly 13 years, from 1857 until his death in 1870. Her full name was Ellen Lawless Ternan, though she was almost always known as Nellie, and will be called Nellie in this book. She was born in 1839, was 18 to Dickens's 45 when they met, and outlived him by 44 years. Clearly, she could have given the world a unique account of his character and life and her part in it. Yet, although she was intelligent, well-educated, and able to express herself in writing, among other things, she helped her sister research and write a literary biography in the 1890s, she never wrote a line about him. In fact, she left no written trace and precious little spoken record of the fact that she had even known him. She was wholly excluded from the great biography of Dickens written by his friend John Forster, who knew her well. No letter to her from Dickens, or from her to Dickens, appears to have survived, and there is no mention of her in the first edition of his letters, which was prepared by two of her close friends, Georgina Hogarth, his sister-in-law, and Mary or Mamie Dickens, his elder daughter. When in 1905 The Dickensian, a scholarly and celebratory magazine, was founded, and its editors were keen to publish reminiscences by anyone who had actually known the great man, no approach was made to Nellie or any other member of her family, and neither she nor her surviving sister Fanny volunteered any contribution. Nellie was not the only member of her family to be blotted out. Fanny, a remarkable woman by any standards, who had also known Dickens well, got similar treatment in the 3-volume autobiography of her own husband, Thomas Adolphus Trollope. She is there, but only as a very shadowy figure. This was not spite, for he was devoted to her and she to him. It was fear of gossip, of scandal, of disgrace. Thomas, born in 1810, was the elder brother of Anthony, and as prolific as all the writing Trollopes, his autobiography is a book of considerable charm, studded with famous literary names. It appeared in the late 1880s and contained a particularly pleasant account of Dickens, whom he had known well. Trollope also knew his sister-in-law Nelly well. She stayed in his Italian and English houses on many occasions. But you would not guess as much from his book. Nor can you glean from it the names of Fanny's parents and sisters, or anything about her hard-working professional past. Nelly and Fanny Ternan were written out for 2 reasons. The first and obvious one is that Nelly was a blot on the good name of Dickens, and the Dickens machinery for public relations was unrivalled. Dickens wished to be, and was, generally worshipped. The word is not too strong for a person who evoked comparison with Christ at the time of his death, as a man of unblemished character, the incarnation of broad Christian virtue, and at the same time of domestic harmony and conviviality. The jolly domestic part of his reputation had been acquired young, through his early novels and his notably exuberant and hospitable family life. It had been crowned by his Christmas stories and never dislodged. It came to exasperate his percipient daughter Kate, but the very fact of her exasperation shows how firmly the legend was established and sedulously kept going in the reminiscences of his more pious children. Amazing as it now seems, the breakup of his family left it unaffected. Dickens preserved his renown as the jovial keeper of hearth, home, children and dogs at Gad's Hill, even as he was ridding himself of wife and children. The public swallowed the carefully maintained domestic image, but it would have been too much to expect it to accept the presence of Nelly in Dickens's life. There is evidence that he himself wavered about this point once or twice, but his friends did not. They made him see the impossibility of any public acknowledgement of a relationship with her. They were also, as a body, remarkable for their loyal silence. Forster's decision not to name or explain her in the biography has been mentioned. It left an emptiness in the chapters covering the last years of Dickens's life, which no subsequent biographer has been able to fill properly. Wilkie Collins, himself a master of the discreet irregular ménage, remained totally discreet about his friend, as did Frank Beard, who was doctor to both Collins and Dickens, and can't have failed to know their private circumstances. So did the other young man who undoubtedly knew something, the journalist George Augustus Suller and Edmund Yates, and Dickens's manager George Dalby. So did Harry Wills, Dickens's assistant on his weekly magazine and his confidant in all private matters. Wills and Collins failed only in not destroying all Dickens's letters to them, some of which contained indiscreet remarks. Dickens's large circle of theatrical friends was also staunchly reticent. The best of these, the retired tragedian William Charles Macready, should, in theory at any rate, have particularly regretted the circumstances of the case, because Macready had struggled all his life to raise the tone of theatrical life and the reputation of actors and actresses. And yet here was Dickens, involving himself with a young actress to the danger of both their reputations. It confirmed all the stereotyped views of the profession. Not only that, Nelly was the daughter of an esteemed colleague of Macready. He had known her father and acted opposite her mother through many seasons. This leads us to the other reason for the blotting out of the name of Ternan. The Ternans were a theatrical clan. Nelly, her 2 sisters, her mother, her aunt and her grandmother were all on the stage, mostly from infancy upwards. They were part of a subculture of British life, which throughout the 19th century was viewed by the rest of society with, at best, equivocal feelings, at worst, alarm. "And you know that this person was on the stage, and you introduced her into my son's family?" The words are put by Thackeray into the mouth of a grandmother who discovers that the modest and blameless family governess was once on the stage. "Pack your trunks, viper, and quit the house this instant. she commands. And the governess's admirer, a respectable young doctor, drops her at the same point with bitter words of blame. Thackeray himself isn't taking sides. The governess is a victim, but she is also deceitful, and the theatre is an immoral place. He lets her marry her widowed employer, but he's a bit frightened of her cool ambition. The jump from actress to governess to lady of the house was made in reality by Fanny Ternan 6 years after Thackeray's story appeared, and Dickens was in some sense the agent of her change, since it was he who recommended her as governess to the child of his widowed friend Tom Trollope. After the marriage, which took place within 5 months of her appointment, neither Fanny nor anyone around her breathed a word about her past career again. Deceitful, perhaps. But the point is that they felt it as necessary to practice this deceit as Dickens felt it necessary to hide his association with Nelly. The Ternan sisters effaced their theatrical past because it was such a liability, because it prevented them from being seen in any light but a theatrical light, and a theatrical light was one that blotted out everything else, disqualified them from any other consideration. Or so they believed. It may seem extraordinary, incomprehensible to us now. It becomes less so if we go back and examine the world in which they were raised and the assumptions made by the people they lived among. The fact that Nelly always expressed particular dislike for the work of Thackeray suggests that she may have recognised and winced at the accuracy of his picture. And actresses, ex-actresses, and the children of actresses make many appearances in his pages. The dancer-turned-governess has shared the stage with ladies who allowed themselves to be installed in cottages in Regent's Park by rich men. Emily Fotheringay, star of the provinces, dazzles innocent young Pendennis and nearly leads him astray with the help of her scheming old Irish father. Morgiana Crump is the daughter of a dancer who has been married to her aristocratic lover's valet, paid off in turn with a public house and a dowry for the child. Becky Sharp in Vanity Fair is also the child of theatrical folk and is herself a terrific mimic, a skill she uses to ingratiate herself on her upward social path. Thackeray loved the theatre and was fascinated by it for exactly the reasons which made the Ternan sisters escape from and deny it. It existed outside the world of Victorian middle-class values of careful self-respect and dignified self-improvement. It appeared to be sexually emancipated, in that it displayed women who were willing to show themselves off, tendering a promise of sophisticated pleasure. Its market values were also more down-to-earth, some would say more honest, than those of the drawing room. Thackeray, Dickens, and Macready all belong to a club named for the great 18th-century actor David Garrick, founded in 1831 with the particular purpose of bringing together the patrons of the drama and its professors and becoming a place in which actors and men of education and refinement might meet on equal terms. This was certainly one of its chief attractions for Dickens, who had a passion for the theatre and made serious preparations to go on the stage professionally himself in 1832. He was an early member of the Garrick, elected in January 1837 when he was only 24 years old, already a successful and distinguished writer and newly married. The professors of the drama mentioned in the prospectus of the club were all, of course, male, although David Garrick was never averse to the company of actresses. Yet the idea of a woman member of the Garrick Club was unthinkable, and still is today. For women, patrons and professors of the drama, equal terms have meant simply that the walls of the club are hung with portraits of actresses. Pictures are one thing, people quite another. "Well, perhaps in the next world women will be more valued than they are in this," grumbled the great Mrs. Sarah Siddons. She knew exactly how equivocal was the admiration accorded even to great actresses. Nellie's portrait is not on the walls of the Garrick, but she did at last reach the steps outside. It was on these steps of the old building that a group of members were standing together on a May evening in 1858, gossiping enjoyably. The subject of their gossip was their fellow member Charles Dickens, by then the best-known writer in England and doubtless in the world. Dickens had just separated formally from his wife Catherine after 22 years of marriage, an almost unheard-of action in high Victorian England. He had done it brutally and publicly, Catherine was not renowned for her beauty or her wit, but she was a clearly blameless mother of 10. And he had insisted on taking her children from her and keeping them under his own care and that of Catherine's younger sister, Georgina Hogarth, who was so much enthralled to Dickens that she braved her family's outrage and the disapproval of the public to remain with him. Only the eldest son, Charlie, defied his father and declared he would make his home with his mother. Dickens was now in the process of quarrelling with anyone who did not accept his version of the separation without question or murmur. He attributed it to a deep and long-established incompatibility between himself and Catherine, made worse by her failure to take any interest in her own children. According to his account, which was backed by Georgina, she did not love them. Dickens went so far as to say that Catherine herself had long desired a separation and that she suffered from a mental disorder. This was flagrantly untrue, as anyone who knew the family could testify, but he was beyond the reach of reason at this point. Gossip had it that Georgina was the real cause of the trouble, and it was this that was being discussed at the Garrick. The idea of a member of the club so distinguished for his celebration of the domestic virtues being caught out in a love affair with a young sister-in-law was certainly scandalous enough to cause a stir of excitement. As Dickens's fellow author and member Thackeray arrived for the evening, he was asked for his opinion. At once, and authoritatively, he denied that the sister-in-law was the cause of the trouble. He had been told the truth at Epsom Races. The affair was not with her at all. "No," says I, "no such thing. It's with an actress." Thackeray's inner reaction, which he set down in a letter to his mother, was dismay at what such a lapse might do to the always slightly precarious reputation of literary men. "Oh, dear me, it's a fatal story for our trade." When Thackeray's words were brought to Dickens, who was equally sensitive to the reputation of the literary trade, he sent him an angry denial. Thackeray obviously did not believe it, and the two men ceased to be friends. They had further reasons for falling out, but Thackeray made a point of being cordial to Mrs. Dickens and showing her continuous courtesy and kindness. We hear of her dining at his house in later years. Dickens was left with his denial, and Thackeray with the view that the man was frantic, half mad about his domestic affairs. Early in June, the story reached the New York Times. Its London correspondent reported that all London had for some time been rife with legends concerning Dickens and an actress with whom it was at last affirmed that the author of David Copperfield had eloped to Bologna. The paper went on to say it was all a lying scandal. This was probably not much comfort to its subject. Dickens, as is well known, published a statement both in the Times and in his own magazine Household Words. It appeared a few days after the New York Times story, in which he denied all the allegations against him. He also forced his in-laws to retract their accusations as a condition for making a proper settlement on Catherine, and he never acknowledged thereafter that he had any private connection with any actress. He was so successful in imposing his version of what had happened on the world that when, 60 years after his death, it was first publicly stated that he had kept a mistress and that she had been an actress, the British public was deeply upset and outraged, and there was a general tendency to protest that it could not be true. In my own family, my grandmother's distress is still remembered. Nor was Nelly very kindly treated on her first appearances in print. From being too bad to be mentioned at all, she became mentioned chiefly to be blamed for her failure to give Dickens what he had hoped for. Wrong to succumb to Dickens, wrong in failing to make him happy, wrong finally because she said later she regretted the whole thing. This became one popular view of her. Mercenary and cold were two of the regular allegations made against her. Edmund Wilson, the most brilliant and influential of Dickens's 20th century critics, saddled her with the character of Estella, the girl reared to torment the male sex in Great Expectations. He suggested Nelly was frigid, indifferent, petulant, spoiled, and proud. He also wrote that money was one of the things that Ellen got out of her liaison with Dickens. True, though not necessarily as disgraceful as Wilson seemed to think. With a last glancing blow, he added that it seems to be the general opinion that Ellen was neither so fascinating nor so gifted as Dickens thought her. He returned to the attack in 1952 in his foreword to Ada Nisbet's short scholarly study of the evidence for the Dickens-Ternan affair. This time he called her not very imaginative or sensitive and not very much interested in Dickens, and held her responsible for leaving him without human contacts, though he did concede that she may not have been so bad as that in his concluding sentence. Wilson's remarks were followed by Edgar Johnson's massive biography of 1952, which has become the standard one. Johnson approached Nelly more cautiously, in flutters of rhetorical questions. Did he, that is Dickens, suspect her of being calculating and mercenary? Was his tenderness shot through with the bitterness of disillusion? He asked in what abyss of personal agony Dickens learned about cold obduracy and love without tenderness or illusion, and whether the promised fictional struggle between Helena Landless and Jasper in Edwin Drood might refer to a real struggle between Dickens and Nelly. On some points Johnson was absolutely clear, though. Dickens had won Ellen against her will, wearing down her resistance by sheer force of desperate determination, and there was no doubt that she failed his need. In the scale of things, Nelly is not an important person. No one would have begun to think about her were it not for Dickens, standing like a giant over the Victorian age, the creator of a dramatic language for his characters that fixes them forever in the mind, and of great set pieces that speak directly to the reader with a verve, a confidence, a springing rhythm, an individuality no other English novelist can rival. But just because Dickens chronicled and charted so much of the life of his generation and protested against so many of its wrongs, his failures and omissions seem all the more striking. He turned his attention onto his own childhood to such good effect that the vulnerability and resilience of children is one of his most common and confidently handled themes. Against this, his difficulty when it comes to creating credible women stands out sharply. Grotesques he can do, Sairy Gamp and Mrs. Gummidge. Before normal female flesh and blood, he falters. As his own daughter Kate said, "My father did not understand women." Whether Dickens understood the woman in his life, about whom we know least, any better than the others, seemed a question worth looking into, even if the material was slender. That was my point of departure. Very soon the quest became something different, its connection with Dickens more tangential. I found, of course, that Nelly's story starts long before her meeting with Dickens, and continues long after his death. It is full of surprises, and in parts is as curious as one of Dickens's own plots. It casts light over a whole area of 19th century life, which is still very shadowy. First the world of professional actresses, then the world of women who knew themselves to be bad and were condemned by respectable people. These are not areas much explored by Dickens, perhaps because he felt them to be too painful, too raw, too dangerous. He knew that in fiction his readers had to be told that bad women came to bad ends. Nelly, flanked by her two remarkable sisters and her courageous mother, is a small piece of reality to set against the omissions and evasions of Victorian fiction, a complicated and resourceful young woman who was very nearly crushed by the huge weight of Dickens on her life, and who fought to save herself in the only way she knew. Biographies of Dickens appear at a rate of rather more than one to the decade. There have been six major ones since the war, buttressed by a great many studies, two volumes of biographical reminiscences of his contemporaries, a Dickens index, and a complete chronology of his life. More important than any of these is the Pilgrim edition of his letters, which, as I write, has reached its sixth volume and the year 1852, a work of impeccable and exhaustive scholarship, which offers not only the best key to Dickens's personality, but also to any reader who cares to browse in its thick underlay of footnotes a rich general impression of the age in which he lived. The great man and the great writer deserve no less. Yet no one can read Dickens without absorbing his interest in the apparently insignificant, the lesser figures at the edge of the picture, the unknown men, women, and children inhabiting the uncharted areas of English society. The poor and the shabby genteel, those who thronged the packed, dirty London streets and the packed, dirty places of entertainment, those who hung on to respectability by their fingernails, and those who let go. One reason for his popularity was precisely this, that his sympathies were with the little people rather than the great. It provides as good a starting point as any for looking into the life of the small figure of the undistinguished actress half hidden at the edge of the Dickensian panorama, Wilson's commonplace person, who has so far attracted little interest in her own right and still less sympathy. 2. Agreeable and beautiful talents. Nelly's history begins with a matriarchy. Her mother and her grandmother, though neither was rich or highly educated, were both independent and enterprising professional women. In each case, their husbands disappeared from the scene when the children were still small. Nelly's mother was about 10 when she lost her father, and Nelly herself was younger still and can have had very little memory of hers. Mother and grandmother were women who earned their own livings, organized their own careers, and managed to bring up their families without the help of husbands, brothers, or sons. This was something so rare in 19th-century England as to set them quite apart from the general experience. The stage was virtually the only profession in which this sort of independence was possible for women at this time. The microcosm of the theatre differed in almost every respect from the social world surrounding it. An actress could, for instance, command payment equal to that of a man or better. She could make her own working contracts. Her horizons, instead of being limited to a domestic circle, were as wide as the English-speaking theatre. She could, and frequently did, flout the prevailing sexual rules. The admirable Fanny Kelly, a contemporary of Nellie's mother, bore and brought up a daughter unassisted and never married. In the same generation, Fanny Kemble left her husband when she found him tyrannous and later divorced him. Mrs. Siddons arranged her life so that she and her husband were never together. Lucia Elisabetta Vestris abandoned her first husband, and Mrs. Abington paid hers an annual sum to keep away. Helen Fawcett, a byword for respectability in the Victorian theatre, was the child of an actress who left her husband, and Helen's early career was actually managed by her mother's lover, the actor William Farren. Ellen Terry took husbands and lovers with a total disregard of what the world might say. Both her children were illegitimate. Fanny Sterling, one of the finest of the mid-century actresses, separated from her husband and lived openly with another man, whom she was able to marry only at the end of her life. And so on. None of these was a wicked woman, but they lived by standards that were quite different from those of their contemporaries, and much closer to those of the late 20th century. Still more remarkable, perhaps, women were accepted as directors and managers. At the very beginning of the century, the Rochester circuit, which had theatres in a good number of Kentish towns, was managed by the efficient and popular Mrs. Baker. In the 1830s, the actress Louisa Nisbet managed first the Queen's Theatre and then the Adelphi, with all that character of taste and propriety which lady managers seem to have a peculiar talent of imparting to such things. Admirable managers they are, and the influence they possess is really extraordinary. So wrote a young theatre critic called Charles Dickens. Another actress, Elizabeth Yates, also managed the Adelphi for a while in the 1840s after the death of her husband. But the best known of the women managers was undoubtedly Lucia Vestris, who described herself as the first of all dramatic Joan of Arcs and brought about a revolution in staging techniques during her 25 years at the Olympic, Covent Garden and the Lyceum between the 1830s and her death in the mid-50s. The theatrical world was hierarchical, with the London stars at the top and the poorest of the provincial strolling players at the bottom of the heap. It was also relatively small and closely interconnected. The great stars depended on their earnings from regular tours of the provinces. They worked with the stock companies and got to know their managers and regular players well in the process. Equally, the provincial companies were the nurseries of talent, and their star performers moved on into London. Tate Wilkinson, for example, who ran the York circuit in the last years of the 18th century, discovered or promoted the talents of a galaxy that included Mrs. Jordan, Mrs. Inchbald, Charles Matthews, and John Kemble. The prompter in Wilkinson's company for many years was John Jarman, Nelly Ternan's grandfather. The children of actors tended to follow their parents onto the stage, and there was both intermarriage and a circulation of the younger or less successful brothers and sisters around the provinces. John Kemble's brother Charles, for instance, married Marie-Thérèse de Caen, bringing two great clans together and producing Fanny Kemble from their union. Miss de Caen had begun her stage career at 6 as Cupid at Drury Lane and later worked for Wilkinson. Her sister Adelaide worked as a girl on the Durham circuit with Stephen Kemble. One de Caen brother managed the Sheffield Theatre, another emigrated to America to become an actor there. Again, Charles Matthews married a clever actress called Anne Jackson, half-sister to Fanny Kelly. Anne's actor father had died, and her mother had married another actor, one of the Irish Kellys, and when this husband abandoned her, she asked her impresario brother-in-law Michael Kelly to train little Fanny for the stage. He did it so well that Fanny was earning the family's bread by the time she was 6, like Marie-Thérèse. Macready, the son of a theatre manager, first saw his wife Kitty Atkins as a child performer of 9 in Glasgow and began his wooing by persuading his own father to give work to her entire family, Mr. Atkins as a stage painter, Mrs. Atkins good only for delivering messages or playing bit parts. Macready called her a female hick or hickess. He made Kitty leave the stage and successfully kept his children from it, but his action was unusual. Charles Kean, son of the great Edmund, was sent to Eton to put ideas of the theatre out of his head, but he could not resist the lure of the stage and made a highly successful career as an actor-manager. The son of Charles Matthews trained and practised as an architect for some years, but again the draw of his parents' world was irresistible. He became almost as celebrated a comic actor as his father, enjoyed a particularly successful professional partnership with Lucia Vestris, and became her second husband. All these couples and families knew one another as fellow workers and friends, and the Ternans were no exception. Nellie's grandparents played with de Caen's, Kemble's, Mrs. Siddons, nay Kemble, Mrs. Jordan, and Charles Matthews. Her mother played with Vestris, Edmund Kean, and Macready. Charles Kean and his wife gave work to Mrs. Ternan and all her daughters. There were quarrels and rivalries, but also a sense of solidarity, and the solidarity was reinforced by the fact that the profession was disapproved of as much as it was admired. The theatre had its own customs, beliefs, and laws of behaviour. While depending on the support of the society around, it maintained itself quite apart, and society showed towards it an intense curiosity. Actresses were the supreme objects of this curiosity. Their position was seen to be especially anomalous. They were certainly not ladies, since ladies by definition did not work. A lady, to be such, must be a mere lady and nothing else. She must not work for profit or engage in any occupation that can command money. Actresses worked for money, and at the same time constantly represented ladies of the most exalted rank on stage. The decorum and polish of their representation was often held up as a model of fine, ladylike behaviour. To pretend to be what you are not, and to make a good job of it, made you morally suspect. Alongside the admiration was a steady stream of abuse directed against actresses, on the grounds that their work was of its very nature damaging to character. The point was made by many writers throughout the century. In Fanny Burney's last novel, The Wanderer, which was published in 1814, her heroine Juliet has no hesitation in preferring the prospect of starvation to a perfectly good offer of work as an actress, because she considers its very nature to be corrupting. In the same year, Jane Austen's Mansfield Park, although it addressed itself only to amateur players, held up the most skilful and enthusiastic participants to particular disapproval. Mary Crawford's charm is part of her inauthenticity. She is a good role player on stage because she is a practiced role player in life, and she is propelled by vanity and self-love. 3 decades later, Thackeray, as we have seen, uses a similar principle when he makes Becky Sharp the child of a theatrical family and herself a skillful amateur actress. Her success springs in part from her ability to fake her feelings. In 1850, in The History of Pendennis, he went further and drew a professional actress, Emily Fotheringay. The emphasis of this portrait is precisely on the rift between the person young Penn falls in love with on stage, a drooping, romantic, poetic heroine, and the prosaic, uneducated and calculating character of the actress offstage. Even her name is false. It is not really Fotheringay, but Costigan. Penn has to learn about this rift between appearance and reality as part of his sentimental and moral education. The implication is that this sort of deception, supremely exemplified in an actress, is what men have to look out for in all their dealings with women. Fotheringay / Costigan is a symbol of the inherent duplicity of all her sex, as well as a socially unacceptable member of it. Socially acceptable, that is, to Penn's family. She is, in fact, a scapegoat for her sex. And although Thackeray goes halfway to admitting that the Fotheringays of this world had little choice about how they were perceived by their admirers, he is too solidly committed to the point of view of the Pendennis clan not to treat her more harshly than he treats them. Elizabeth Prior, or Bessie Bellenden, who appeared for some years at the St. James's Theatre in Spangles and then escaped into governessing, has already been mentioned in Chapter 1. She is Thackeray's last equivocal heroine, and Lovell the Widower was written at the end of his life when he was acknowledged as the writer who came nearest to presenting the standards of gentlemen to his contemporaries. He is markedly ambivalent about her, showing her as deceitful, but also brave, hard-working, attractive, and even lovable. A fighter who uses whatever weapons are available to her in a world which he knew allowed her very few. Elizabeth's past is not her fault, but it has made her a dangerous person to introduce into a conventional family. When that past is revealed, the young doctor who has been in love with her departs, sobbing with vexation. "It wasn't fair not to tell me. It wasn't fair. I couldn't ask a party into my family who has been... And he can't even bring himself to say what she has been. The Encyclopaedia Britannica had set the tone for all this with its article on actresses in 1797. "There are some very agreeable and beautiful talents, of which the possession commands a certain sort of admiration, but of which the exercise for the sake of gain is considered, whether from reason or prejudice, as a sort of public prostitution. The pecuniary recompense, therefore, of those who exercise them in this manner must be sufficient not only to pay for the time, labour, and expense of acquiring the talents, but for the discredit which attends the employment of them as the means of subsistence. The exorbitant rewards of players, opera singers, opera dancers, etc., are founded upon these two principles, the rarity and beauty of the talents, and the discredit of employing them in this manner. It seems absurd at first sight that we should despise their persons and yet reward their talents with the most profuse liberality. While we do the one, however, we must of necessity do the other. Such talents, though far from being common, are by no means so rare as imagined. Many people possess them in great perfection who disdain to make this use of them. And many more are capable of acquiring them if anything could be made honourably by them." The assumption behind these words seems to be that the exercise of any talent by a woman in public is a form of prostitution. Fanny Kelly, who was 7 at the time the article appeared, and as we have seen already working to keep her family fed, expressed her just fury with it later, and her determination to change such an attitude lay behind her attempt to establish a school for young actresses in the middle of the century. The association between prostitution and the stage was made over and over again. Of course, theatres did attract prostitutes into the audience. Behaviour was often rough and riotous, and in the first half of the century at least, drinking and eating and smoking took place unrestrainedly in the pit and the gallery. Mrs. Jordan's letters talk of riots, the constables being called in, and the theatre smelling like a taproom by the end of the evening. The atmosphere was one in which prostitutes could expect to find clients. Everybody knew, too, that actresses themselves were popular with gentlemen in search of beautiful companions, though the blame for this can hardly be laid entirely upon them. Fanny Kelly's experience is instructive again. When the Earl of Essex tried to force his attentions on her, she turned him away angrily and reminded him that she was friendly with his wife, and that for her sake only she would continue to tolerate his acquaintance. Other actresses accepted what was oddly called the protection of their aristocratic admirers, the most famous among them being Dora Jordan, who bore 10 children to the Duke of Clarence between 1794 and 1810. She already had 4 when they met. Mrs. Jordan, who invented her own name and was never married, was the foremost comedienne of her day, possibly the best-loved actress ever seen on the English stage, extolled by Hazlitt and Byron, among others. But this did not prevent her from coming to a miserable end when the Duke decided he must marry a rich wife and she grew too old and tired to go on working. Had his love continued, and had the laws pertaining to royal marriages been what they are today, we might have had an actress as Queen of England in 1830 and one of her sons on the throne as king in 1837 in place of Queen Victoria. The idea of this narrow escape naturally inflamed some British subjects, particularly those who held that she was a disgrace and deserved her wretched end. Note: in the next generation, another royal prince, the second Duke of Cambridge, did actually marry an actress, Louisa Fairbrother, and lived in domestic happiness with her and their sons in Mayfair for the rest of his life. But even though he was not in the direct line, it had to be a morganatic marriage, which meant the children could not succeed to his title. Mrs. Jordan earned a great deal of money. She probably gave the Duke more financial help than he gave her at times during their association. Money and mercenariness particularly worried those who made it their business to comment on actresses. A memoir of Madame Vestris, published in the late 1830s, alleged that actresses habitually made a handsome living by seducing the sons of the nobility. In practice, only those skillful enough to get their admirers to the altar seem to have made sure of financial security by this means. Apart from this glittering handful, few achieved more than modest comfort, and many ended in destitution. Fanny Kemble, always a good witness, noted the pathetic gratitude of a 70-year-old actress in Liverpool who got the part of nurse to her Juliet and drew her own conclusions. The saying that playhouses lead to workhouses was based in bitter truth. Even the Kemble family, though its members earned huge sums and achieved a social position of some eminence, never managed to match it with financial security. Fanny Kelly, also a star for many seasons, ended her long life penniless. A pension was got for her when she was in her 90s from Gladstone, just in time to pay her funeral expenses. It was hard, if not impossible, for an actress to present an acceptable financial face to the world. If she was poor, she was considered feckless. If she married a rich man, she was an adventuress. If she bargained with managers, was careful with her money, and tried to put some aside, she was accused of avarice. This was said of Miss O'Neill, of Mrs. Siddons, Vestris, and Jordan. Mrs. Jordan suffered the cruelest fate of all. Her royal lover, who had fondly watched her appear on stage throughout their 20 years together, made it a condition when he dismissed her that she should lose the care of her daughters should she return to the stage. Soon she was obliged to do so. She needed the money for her other children, and saw her daughters taken away, and so died alone. Of her sons, who were given titles and half absorbed into the aristocracy, the eldest committed suicide. Another, Lord Adolphus Fitzclarence, took to hanging about Drury Lane to see his mother's old dressing room, and spoke with understandably bitter disrespect of his father when he was on the throne as William the Fourth. Actresses themselves sometimes worried about the moral aspect of their work on the grounds that it encouraged personal vanity. Although some, Vestris, who kept her physical charm into her 50s, and Jordan in her happy years, clearly enjoyed exhibiting their talent and beauty, others were troubled by the public display of their bodies, always referred to as their persons. Fanny Kemble said more than once that she found performing profoundly distasteful, and believed that the public exhibition of herself did a violence to her womanly dignity. She considered the excitement unwholesome and the personal exhibition odious. Another actress wrote of the consciousness that one's person was a target for any who paid to make it one, the idea of being a target while expressing her sense of vulnerability. Fanny Kelly became a literal target when one of her admirers, thrown into a state of excited indignation by her appearance on stage as a boy in breeches, aimed a pistol shot at her from the auditorium. Fortunately, he missed, but he could hardly have conveyed the ambivalence of the admiration accorded to actresses more graphically. Bridges' parts were enormously popular with audiences, which did not prevent critics from censuring the actresses who played them for their immodesty in dressing in men's clothes. Even if she was careful not to appear seductive or mercenary, an actress must expect to be despised by decent people. So Mrs. Patrick Campbell was told by her aunt in the 1880s. When the 47-year-old painter G.F. Watts proposed to the 17-year-old Ellen Terry in 1864, he explained that his chief motive was that he wanted to remove her from the temptations and abominations of the stage and was prepared to compensate her parents financially for their loss of her earnings. And when he dismissed her from the marriage, he gave her a settlement which would be reduced if she returned to her career. At about the same time, the daughter of Samuel Phelps was expelled from her boarding school at the request of a parent who discovered simply that she came from a family of actors. She hadn't begun to be one herself, but no doubt she would soon be a victim of the vanity and lax principles prevailing in theatrical circles. "Would any one of us wish our daughters to go on the stage?" thundered the editor of Punch in the 1880s. "There can be but one answer to this. No!" A well-brought-up girl would react to the stage in one of two ways, either recoiling in disgust at life behind the scenes and fleeing, or else succumbing to its corruption until the fixed lines of the moral boundary have become blurred and faint. Punch grudgingly conceded that women brought up from childhood within the theatre might in some way be immunised against its moral infection, though it is hard to see how this process was meant to come about. In the next decade, another journalist returned to the attack. "It is nearly impossible for a woman to remain pure who adopts the stage as a profession. There is no school on earth so bad for the formation of character," wrote Clement Scott in 1898. Essentially, his attitude was not very different from that of the encyclopedists of the 1790s. The truth is that to succeed as an actress, you needed to be a woman of exceptional courage, intelligence, and self-reliance. You had to be prepared to work yourself to the bone, to ignore sickness, pregnancy, and childbirth, as well as bereavement and any other personal distress. You had to be tough enough to endure the harsh opinion of the world, as well as homelessness and discomfort. You had to know how to be a queen or a model of ladylike composure on stage, just after emerging from a dressing room with the rain pouring through the ceiling. Being an actress meant, more than anything, that you were prepared for a life of risk. Freedom, of a kind, and real work that was not domestic work, these set you apart from the general condition of women. Marriage outside the profession almost always meant giving it up and disappearing into obscurity, even if it was aristocratic obscurity. It seemed a good bargain to many, though some, on being widowed, returned to the stage, and one, at least, Miss Peyton, ran away from her aristocratic husband, Lord William Lennox, fled to America with an actor, and became a working woman again. The actress heroine of Henry James's novel, The Tragic Muse, turns down the well-born diplomat who proposes marriage and opts for a nonentity of a husband who is in the theatre and will serve her and promote her career instead of detaching her from it. The scene in which she asks the diplomat if he would give up his career for her is incidentally a remarkable and brilliant statement of the feminist case. It was written in 1890, and James was clear that an actress was the right mouthpiece for these ideas. Perhaps some had come through his friend Fanny Kemble, who found herself penniless, homeless, and deprived of her children when she divorced her husband. Outstanding women appear as actresses throughout the century, sometimes among the most obscure provincial players. Mrs. Charlotte Deans, who published her memoirs in 1837, ran away from a prosperous home to marry an actor and spent 70 years tramping the north of England and Scotland as a strolling player, appearing in theatres, trade halls and castles, to which she brought Molière, Shakespeare, Schiller, Otway, Vanbrugh, Centlivre, dramatisations of Walter Scott, and even Coleridge's play Remorse. The family walked from town to town, sometimes carrying their children through snowdrifts. When she had borne 10 children, in these circumstances, her first husband died. She was 35 and quickly remarried. Her second husband was another actor, aged 22. They continued to act together. She had 7 more children and outlived him too. She was still touring on foot in her 60s and died at the age of 90 in 1859. Marriage to a younger husband was not unusual among actresses. Lucia Vestris took Charles Matthews as her second husband in 1838, when he was 35 and she 41. It was said that the marriage was made primarily to enable them to visit America together without causing scandal, and that Vestris made full confession of her other previous lovers to Matthews, causing one fellow actress to exclaim at her remarkable memory. In spite of this, it seems to have been a happy marriage, was highly productive professionally, and lasted until her death in 1856. Yet Matthews' biographer, writing in 1879, came close to eliminating Vestris from his account of Matthews' life. The biographer was Charles Dickens, Jr., and his attitude was, after all, a common enough Victorian one. This long preamble is necessary to the story of the Ternans if we are to see them in context and understand something of the world into which Nelly was born, to a mother of 38 who throughout her life had never stopped travelling in England, Scotland, Ireland and America, who was still better known to her public as Miss Fanny Jarman than Mrs. Frances Ternan, though she'd already given birth to 2 children, who was still playing Portia, Cordelia, Desdemona, and her usual repertoire of youthful leading roles a few weeks before the birth, and was ready to return to the stage again a few weeks later, who had been born into the Tate-Wilkinson Company, grown up in the Regency Theatre, acted as a child with all its great names, and observed its values, rewards, and dangers with a clear, intelligent eye. 3. Family Saga, 1790-1845. This is how Nelly's grandmother started her stage career and her married life. A Yorkshire girl, she applied to Tate Wilkinson for work when she was 21, calling herself Miss Errington, though her real name was a more down-to-earth Martha Maria Mottershed. Wilkinson took her on partly because there was a gap in the company caused by the sudden death of one of the company's leading actresses, Mrs. Georgiana Jarman, in the full bloom of her youth. The bereaved husband, John Jarman, was the company prompter. He had been with Wilkinson for a decade and is said to have been a lawyer before he took to the stage. His job was a good one, for a prompter did very much more than hold the book. He regularly played parts, understudied for all the men, and made casting decisions in the manager's absence. He kept a list of all the lodgings in the towns on the Yorkshire circuit, and he was the person who knew everything about the affairs of the company and to whom everyone turned when they had a problem. Evidently, he took the new actress under his wing, and soon she was filling the gap left by Georgiana, not only on stage but in private. Within a very short time, Martha Maria was pregnant by Jarman. He was less quick to save her honour than he had been to attack her virtue, and the wedding took place only 3 months before the birth of the child by special licence in Doncaster on the 15th of October 1801. Wilkinson gave the whole company a free day. They moved straight on to Hull, and Miss Errington continued to travel the circuit and to appear on stage until 3 days before her confinement. On the 8th of February 1802, she gave birth to a daughter, Frances Eleanor Jarman, in her lodgings above a shop in Elephant and Castle Yard, Hull. Downstairs, her husband continued to sell tickets for the night's performance. Within 8 weeks, she was back on stage again. Wilkinson grumbled at how often his ladies were in the straw, but he was kind-hearted, tolerant, and worldly wise. And the other women of the company were not going to despise Miss Errington for a circumstance which was common enough, even if Miss Decamp, who was to marry Charles Kemble, and Miss Jackson, who was to marry the comedian Charles Matthews, did not allow themselves the same license. Jarman put himself down as 25 on his wedding day, but since he'd been married for at least 10 years to his first wife, this was probably a slip of the pen. Mrs. Jarman continued to act and continued to bear children. A second daughter, Mary Ann, was born and died when Frances was 1, and a third, Louisa, followed soon after. Before that, in fact before she was 2, Frances was appearing on stage as the child in Sheridan's drama Pizarro, and as another child in Monk Lewis's musical pantomime Raymond and Agnes, or The Bleeding Nun. She was billed formally as Miss Jarman. Her professional debut was evidently more important than her reception into the church, for it preceded her christening by some months. This took place only in November 1804 at St. George's Church in Doncaster. Either her parents had been too busy to remember to arrange it, or too much on the move to find time for it. Religion seems to have played a very small part in the life of the family. Other children were born to the couple, but the only ones known to survive were Louisa and Frances, who was her mother's pride. By the time she was five, she was playing a whole range of parts. Wilkinson knew his audiences loved to see children on stage and obliged them whenever possible, though his own son John was nine before he started. Even where there were no lines, children could be sent on as pages or fairies or part of a crowd. And so they grew up knowing the business from the start, moving from lodging to lodging with the backstage as home and the company as family. They learnt to dance and sing and devise their own costumes. They absorbed the language of Shakespeare and Sheridan. They worked by night and slept when they could. From the time they could walk, work and play were almost indistinguishable in their lives. They lived apart from the other world of people with settled homes and habits. And very early must have understood that while they commanded applause and admiration, they were also sometimes reviled. Wilkinson always gave his players their honorary title of Their Majesty's Servants on the playbills. He also noted in his memoirs the view of a certain Mr. Garwood, a low churchman, who declared that no player or child of a player was entitled to Christian burial because all were damned eternally. Wilkinson went to meet his maker's judgment in 1803, before Frances was launched. Soon she was playing the boy in The Children in the Wood, Fleance in Macbeth, Mamilius in The Winter's Tale, the small Duke of York in Richard III. The company continued under young John Wilkinson. And as before, its most successful members continued to move away to London, where Covent Garden and Drury Lane offered more glittering rewards. But the Jarmans were a fixture. They travelled the same circuit, usually going from York to Leeds, on to Pontefract, back to York, then Wakefield, Doncaster and Hull, with occasional stops at Beverley or forays as far as Sheffield. They did the same plays, Shakespeare, Otway, Sheridan, Mrs. Inchbald, sometimes Milton's Comus, and then innumerable farces, pantomimes and musical entertainments, whose authors were never named on the playbills. Sometimes there were dancing dogs, sometimes trick effects like the Italian shadows, in which lights were used to make the characters appear as tall as leaping giants. Moonlight was produced by getting a boy on a ladder to hold a pair of candles behind some gauze. Young actresses recited William Collins's Ode on the Passions as a set piece between plays, performed comic or patriotic monologues, danced the hornpipe, or put on military uniform and went through mimic manoeuvres. The company continued to receive visits from the great, among them Mrs. Siddons, with whom little Frances acted in Leeds in 1805. In 1810 came Mrs. Jordan, whose charm and beauty no other comic actress could equal. With her, both Mrs. Jarman and her daughter acted on several occasions. Mrs. Jordan wrote her own account of conditions on the Yorkshire circuit at this time. At Leeds she found her dressing room floor so wet that she had to stand on her greatcoat while she was changing. At Hull the audience cracked nuts and threw the shells at the stage. They drink porter and about 10 o'clock actually eat bread and cheese. By the time the performance is over the house and stage smell like a tap room. The following year, in the same city, there was a set of drunken sailors in the boxes who wanted to come behind the scenes and there was very nearly a riot. Wilkinson behaved very resolutely and well by sending for the constables and having them forced out of the house. We could not go on with the play, which I was very glad of as I got home very soon. Drunken sailors were not the worst she had to face. One letter from an unknown correspondent, received while she was in Yorkshire, told her that God had allowed me to make use of magic for a certain time, and that he was only watching for a good opportunity to send me to the Gulf of Hell, spelt G-U-L-P-H. What an idea to entertain of the mercy and justice of a great being, remarked this intelligent woman. All the same, hatred and malice like this is disconcerting. Frances Jarman was nine when she played in Andrew Cherry's The Soldier's Daughter with Mrs. Jordan as the widow Cheerley, it was normally her mother's part, at the Theatre Royal York. In her letters from York that August of 1811, Mrs. Jordan commented that the houses were poor and it seemed that young Wilkinson was on the verge of ruin. She was right. He kept the company going for a couple of seasons more, but with increasing difficulty. In January 1812, the whole Jarman family twice appeared in Hull with Mrs. Siddons. It was her last season on stage and the last season of the Wilkinson management, which was disbanded in 1813. The actors scattered, picking up what work they could in other travelling groups. Jarman seems to have found nothing, perhaps because he was ill, and by 1814 he had either died or disappeared from the scene, leaving his young widow or wife and children to fend for themselves. What they felt about his loss is unrecorded, but Mrs. Jarman and her daughters made a brave and determined little team. Frances was 12, Louisa 10. They moved south to Bath, where there was a flourishing resident company. For the mother, there were no more leading parts. She was glad to pay nurse to young Macready's Romeo, but there were prospects for the daughters. And in Bath, Frances, blonde, fine-featured, graceful and obviously gifted, was nurtured through the awkward years, playing a rather mature Duke of York to Edmund Kean's Richard III in 1815 and giving valiant recitations of the popular poems of the day. At 17, she graduated to Perdita and Jeanie Deans in one of the innumerable adaptations of Scott, and was found highly interesting by John Genest, the historian of the British stage, who resided in Bath and acted as self-appointed expert on the status and progress of British actors and actresses. He described her as somewhat above middle.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.